Right, this is my UFC on Fuel TV 5 recap video. This is the one that took place in Nottingham, which, if you know England, is slightly backwater. Maybe they'll host one in Derby next, who knows. A mixed bag. Stefan Struve managed to pull it out, but he did not win the first round. I think it was a little bit of a comeback fight, that I just slightly concerned. The knockout, well, if you can call it a knockout, I suppose the guy was sort of absorbing punches while he was dead on his feet. But it was in the second round, and it was a little bit of a comeback. He wasn't going to be knocked out easily. Just slightly concerned that had that gone to a decision, Stefan Struve may not have been so lucky at that. And I'm not sure that the decision victory that Dan Hardy managed to score did him, you know, much good either. Like I said, it wasn't a squash match, and that was proved by the fact it went all the way to decision. I wouldn't have spent quite so long trying to get an armbar had I been a mere Sodala, I have to admit, but there we are. I outlined my problems with this fight in the prediction video, and I don't really want to repeat them, but there we are, that covers that. Brad Pickett, yes. And now we get on to the difficult fight, which was the Paul Sass fiasco, I suppose you could say. I think that, and I did make concessions and say that I thought Matt Wimmen was at the level slightly above Jacob Volkman. I think that a lot of people were surprised by the result. Maybe not that it was going to be a submission fest. I don't know about that. I have to say that had Paul Sass not lost whatever leg lock it was early in the first round, I still think that he would have won. I also think that he would have been able to escape the armbar attack had it not been that he was sort of smushed up against the fence. I'm not going to say that Matt Wimmen got lucky, because obviously the technique, you know, he was equally as game. It was not, if you had to give, if the first round went all the way to an end and you had to say who had won that round, I think that would be quite hard to judge. So by no means am I saying that, you know, Matt Wimmen was just, you know, it was a one-off fluke. But I do think that he has a knack occasionally of being able to beat people that are above his calibre. I do think that circumstances being as they were, you know, I could have seen at least one place where had Paul Sass not let go of the submission, I think it would have ended. And I do have to say that, you know, smushed up against the fence, it's just I don't think that would repeat itself again if they met again, and that's how I'm going to view that. I don't actually think that it's done Paul Sass much damage, I have to say, because a lot of people, interestingly, a lot of people, despite Matt Wimmen's background, were saying they thought that Sass would win, and therefore the fact he lost is not has not been reflected like a, oh dear, he was, you know, better than we thought. It's actually been classed as an upset, and oh my god, Matt Wimmen's actually managed to win. It seems to have gone down that way, rather than, well, you know, Paul Sass, English, yes, well, blah, blah, blah. So I'm pleased about that. I think that probably means that, you know, he'll be able to sort of bounce back and continue without it being too much of a setback. But I thought I would clear that up. I don't know if there's anything else I want to say. Oh, yes, unfortunate about what happened with Dwayne Ludwig. an injury ended that match, and Jimmy Manua went on a lot longer than I thought it would. I thought he would manage to get a knockout earlier. I mean, he didn't get a knockout in the end. It was stopped between rounds, but it was due to strikes. My man of the card is going to be Andy Ogle, and there's a good reason for this, okay? Andy Ogle lost by split decision to Akira Korizani, who I seem to know, have heard of, and don't know where from. Maybe it's because of what he did in the match that I've heard of him, I don't know. But some of you will note, at the end of one of the rounds, I think it was the second, but it could have been the first, I can't remember, there was some sort of blow dealt way after the horn, and nobody seemed to notice, not even the referee. Bit surprised at that, because that I hate low blows, and I do hate that sort of low blow more than, you know, most. And I just felt, you know, with it being a split decision and it being a close fight, that for me, you know, that would rule it out. I would think, you know, yeah, if you cannot distinguish between them, you know, any way other than the fact that one of them has given an illegal blow, or be it accidental or not, that's a distinguishing feature of the fight in my eyes. Now, he didn't get the decision, split decision victory, because the referee didn't seem to care. The judges don't seem to care. They never do about low blows. For all the blah that the UFC do go on about fighter safety, the one thing that they have never tackled in clearing up is low blows. They've never laid proper sanctions on people who do it all the time. Now, I'm not saying that Akira Korizani always does. I don't know, because I don't think I've ever seen him fight before. And yet somehow I do seem to know. The name sounds terribly familiar. But anyway, I'm not saying that he's, you know, does this all the time, or that it was deliberate or anything like that. But there are people that do it deliberately, and they get away with it. And I just think, you know, mistake or not, deliberate or not, it shouldn't happen. And in a close fight, I think that that's unacceptable. And I do wish the UFC and all the sporting regulatory bodies would take the same attitude, because that is care about fighter safety. That is saying, look, if you cannot distinguish between people who won and lost, and you don't want to give draws, the other way to do it is to say, look, anybody who does any illegal blows, that counts as points deducted. So for that reason, I'm going to give, and because there's no other particular good reason to give it to anybody else, I'm going to give my Fighter of the Card award to Andy Ogle.